thank you. I was given this topic to talk. It's very difficult. I don't know what I'm going to do. But I will try to understand the topic by myself, and probably some of you will understand. So this is a collaboration between various organizations and institutions, and particularly the Sports Research Laboratory, National Center of Toxicological Research, Dr. V. Sikri is here, the director, Uppsala University, and NIDA, Dr. Barry Hopper is here, so it's a large collaboration. And I do not go more on this slide because Dr. Wang has explained. I just tell you that there are several words used for neuroestheratology. And I have a great honor. I don't want to introduce him because Dr. Weisman is well known. And there are three important persons who show that regeneration is still possible in adults. Dr. Weisman is one. And then my colleague, Dr. Weisman. He is one of the pioneers in spinal cord injury research. And Dr. Huang, and you can see that lantern is confined in the endothelial cell, and all of this electrons is injected into the brain normally, the barrier is normal, they are not coming into the blood, so they do not have another effect. But we believe that in all disease conditions or traumatic lesions, probably this barrier is also opened up. But we have not so much data. This is Dr. Eric Stolberg. I just was talking to you. He started work on a spinal cord injury in early 1988 to understand the bridge between electrical events and neuropathology. And my other colleague is from Spinal. At that time, we were interested in electrophysiological recording and pathological connection. And in this case, Dr. Dimitrijevich has written a very good way, you too. So, thank you very much. At that time, always we are talking about clinical cases and basic research. And this is a huge, matter to talk in almost every congress. But we must confess that we cannot compare clinical situation with animal experiments. Because we must remember that animal experiments are done under anesthesia. And at one point of time, the injury factor is only one. Whereas in clinical situation, a motor vehicle accident, it is in conscious situation. And many other factors are occurring simultaneously. I don't have time, I'm not elaborating this. And to you, this is quite common that most of the important cause of a spinal cord injury is motor vehicle accident. When we tried to work, Dr. Ingebrigtsen said that no models available are perfect. So what we should study? We should study perifocal lesion changes within a short period of time so that we can understand that how they are developing the pathological process. As I told you, now this is time to understand or consider that what may happen in neuroregisteratology. We are using normal animals, probably healthy animals, and making lesions. But in human population, many persons are diseased. They have hypertension. They have diabetes. They are living in certain environments where the pollutions are much more. They are intoxicated with various pollutants, including some nanoparticles or microfine particles. We should not believe that the injury occurring to those people, the pathogenesis or pathophysiology will be same, or whether the same dose of the drug will affect or try to cure them. So now this is the time, we must consider these external factors, for example, environment pollution, hypothermia, internal factors, means disease, hypertension, diabetes, and so on. So this is the model that we developed, and in 5 hours, we see much more injury, and these are some treatment. I'm not going in detail. The problem is that our model seems to be working in English laboratory at that time. Electrophysiology, some of you are more expert than me, but our idea at that time was that try to understand this evoked potential above and below the lesion. And what we found that when we miss an injury, the amplitude above the lesion was flattened immediately, but below the lesion was in fact increased. I don't have so much time to explain this phenomenon. I can only conclude that it means that the area above the lesion and below the lesion are not same when a spinal cord injury is made. So pathological correlates. 5 hours after injury, spinal cord is swollen compared to normal. And it is just showing different unions of the spinal cord, and we can see that once you meet it, it's increasing over a period of 12 hours. And some fine details I am omitting here, I can only say that even the leakage was different in above or below the injury site. So they behave differently. This is very similar also with radioiodine. The only difference is that if we use radioiodine tracer, we can detect leakage after 5 minutes. But with the advanced loop, nothing we can see before 1 hour. So it means the tracer size is also important. It means our methods are important to detect the variant. As a neuropathologist, we believe in seeing the things. And again, I am grateful to Ingebrigtsen. In his laboratory, you can see that lanthanum here is confined in the basal lamina, and one endothelial cell was completely infiltrated. The others are not. I think this was the first finding from Uppsala University, because previously we believed that it is always opening by widening of tight junction. So this was one of the important findings, and then we to modulate with drugs, not the idea to develop the treatment, because still there are no treatments, but to understand the role of microvascular permeability in making cell injury. So we can see that the areas where there are injuries, like myelin reticulation, we can see lanthanum deposit. I do not say that they are related. But the other important thing we found is that the tight junctions were not wired to lanthanum. And this is again showing edema, because here the neuropathologist will understand that leakage of albumin will produce edema, and that is in most of the cases very tightly correlated. If we have opening of the barrier, we can see neuronal damages, and that is quite clear here on the lower side. This is normal. As I told you before, that we have glial cells much more high in number, and here you can see that after injury, astrocyte activation by GFAP, even there were differences from right side, injured side, and uninjured side. So it means that glial cells are also very responsive within 5 hours. And obviously, this myelin basic protein, the basic thing of the spinal cord, you can see this is controlled, and after injury, the color and also the fibers are much less. At that time, people believed that what we are doing could be pathological art, because these experiments were done in 1990. People are not going to believe nowadays this proteomic genomics. They believe in seconds. Anyway, so then we have seen that CPOS expression is increased not in the lesion side, but the area adjacent to lesion side, but not injured. So this means that something is occurring inside the spinal cord. And looking at electron microscope, you can see that this is T9 left responder vessel style. Microvessel looks like this. Myelin reticulation is this. But right side is much more damaged. So still, morphologically, we can see slight difference. Coming to therapy, it is very difficult in vivo situation to pinpoint one or two factors. But I have some privilege of being a basic researcher that still we can manipulate with some of the factors one by one. In clinical cases, likewise, we have very difficult to find control groups to compare with. But we are lucky in basic situation because we can have good control. So going quickly over that, we have used brain-derived neurotrophic factor, and then before, why brain-derived only when the spinal cord or brain has so many other things? So we tried also glial-derived neurotrophic factor and a combination. And you can see that combination looks much better than the BDNF alone. These are just giving an example comparison with insulin like growth factor 1 and BDNF, whether given in same dose, not in same micromoles. And what you can see that 5 to 30 minutes, they are very good after injury. And IGF-1 could be better. It is too premature experiment to say, but we can see that IGF-1 may have some better results. This is showing iodine extravasation, the same pattern. Now at that time, we wanted to study, or some questions were asked, how and why these BDNF and IGF-1 applied locally can have neuroprotection. Then we study nitric oxide synthase upregulation, and you can see that BDNF and IGF-1, they are able to block this nitric oxide synthase upregulation, means something is happening inside the spinal cord. We tested this at electron microscopy, and you can see that BDNF treated, there is no leakage of lanthanum compared to the untreated. So it means if we want to have neuroprotection, probably we have to see that the barrier permeability becomes normal. How many minutes? At least 10. Then we wanted to test our hypothesis that whether we are right or wrong, and since this is basic research, we try to see why nitric oxide. We have also carbon monoxide. And this is just an example that we used HO2 type. This is constitutive, not inducible one. I'm not going into the controversy, but you can see that when we have given a drug started some work with Rafael Huang, experimenter. He is clinician, he doesn't like so much basic experiments, but we convinced him that let us do something together. And then, you know that there are so many neurotropic factors, and we should do something, try to mix. And this is the example I'm showing you. So what happens? This is spinal cord injury, acute. CNTF alone and CNTF, BDNF, TDNF, triple treatment was the best in reducing Gerber barrier for spinal cord barrier leakage. But the others were much less. Although as compared to the non untreated, they were very good. The water content always followed the same pattern of the leakage, and again the triple combination was quite good. Blood flow treatment, it goes opposite because ischemia can produce neural injury. So triple treatment elevates the local circulation compared to the normal level, not mean it's like that. Neuronal damage always follow the edema and barrier leakage, so let us tell you that triple combination was better. Then we analyzed semi-quantitative HO2 expression, and we can also see that the triple combination was the best in reducing the number of HO2 expression. This is an example of HO2 expression, untreated, BDNF, IGF, 1, and another example, two different examples. And then we also see here that the combination, triple combination, is the best. But the problem is not over. We thought that we have climbed, we are on great wall, but the problems are lying ahead. Because great wall is unlimited and no one probably run on all the great wall in China. So then we started some collaboration with Dr. Fong in Xi'an, and he thought that we have bradykinin that is also an edema inducing factor. But it can do it. Bradykinin 2 antagonist in low and high doses, making the story short, in low doses it produces neuroprotection, in high doses it has opposite effect. And you can see here that is spinal cord barrier, nitric oxide synthase preservation, they are well correlated. And the picture is very same, high doses much severe action, low doses were neuroprotective. So it is also important, the dose of the drug and timing of administration. I am not telling you the timing of administration. At this time, there are pre-treatment or some immediately after injury. And this is also edema formation. So the dose, timing, all play an important role. And here is some example of nitric oxide synthase expression. If our theory is right, then when we have neuroprotection, it also related to here is normal, and here is after a spinal cord injury, and you can see that bradykinin antagonist given before is reducing that. So separately, bradykinin is also involved, neurotropins are also involved, and this is Dr. Fong. He enjoyed our trip in Beijing some years ago, and on the basis of our research cooperation with the United States, China, Europe, and other things, suddenly government of India realized that we are doing some good work. So, this is Deputy Minister and this is Chief Justice of Supreme Court. They try to honor us. Finally, I will show you our association with electrical events and pathology. I'm showing some examples. Those drugs that were able to induce neuroprotection, they are also able to block the loss of tissue cross-replication site. PCPA, neuroprotection, nimodipine was the best, but thiopurine, all other drugs, they did not do good. These results were taken 2 minutes, these are different up to 10 minutes, and then we studied the pathology. I can only show with this example that tissue of this evoked potential on the rostral side did not alter very much. They were damaged or increased in all the cases. It is just showing different drugs that are neuroprotective, where reduce the leakage and more. Pyrosa. And this is an example. You can see those drugs were able to reduce this loss of hand tissue on the rostral side, they are neuroprotective. And those drugs not doing that, they did not protect the spinal cord at all. And obviously, this C4 depression was also reduced by PCPA. Microvascular permeability disturbances, you can see that the drugs that were able to reduce, they block the barrier, but the others are not. This is also the neuropil was less damaged. Another example of several changes. And there is a very tight correlation between loss of early negative hand tissue and what happened. So we were also surprised that Grenadima Association in Tokyo, they have given us this Anthony Marmarau Award. Some of you might be knowing Anthony Marmarau. He died recently. And he was the pioneer in basic research on closed head injury. And he believes that brain edema and blood-brain barrier relation is very important in treating patients. I will not go to this slide. And I can only tell you what is the relationship between experimental cases and human cases. We have no idea, but we obtained some human spinal cord traumatized motor vehicle accidents from Perth, electrobiome, and Texas, is one of the renowned neurologists. And we did the same experiment in our laboratory and found that endogenous albumin leakage after 6 hours is quite frequent and with a specific pattern in the spinal cord. So, what we can understand from these very loose ends, that probably the blood spinal cord barrier is very important in making this neuropathological damage. And here I would remind you, I'm not showing these slides, but we must consider that endogenous problems like hypertension, diabetes, or exogenous problems like environmental pollution will affect these pathological changes very much. And therefore, we must consider the future of neuropathology.